Hey, what's up? My name's Ercy, and welcome back to my channel where I talk all things books that come into my life. In this video, we're going to talk all about The Memory Police by Yoko Ogawa, translated by Stephen Snyder. For this video, we're going to be doing sort of the same thing I've been doing in all my other review style videos, where I'm going to break it down into certain categories or topics. So there will be time cards in the description along this whole video. So feel free to skip around if that's what you desire. You're more than welcome to watch it all the way through. We're going to talk about why I picked up this book, what it's about, the genre, what I liked, what I disliked, my rating, and who I recommend this book for. So with all of that out of the way, let's just start talking about the book. Let's talk about why I picked up this book in the first place. So this book specifically, I heard about it from Russel over on the Ink and Paper blog. I'll leave a link to his channel in the description box of this video. But he talked about this book specifically, and it was one of his favorites from like 2019. And so it's been on my mind for a while. I decided one day while I was at the bookstore that I was just going to pick it up. And then I spoke about it in a video where I talked about different books that I picked up. And on that video, Amanda from The Reading and Writing Life asked if she wanted to do a buddy read with me on any of the books from that video. And I chose this one, The Memory Police. So we had a really good time talking about it over on Discord, sharing our thoughts back and forth as we reached certain checkpoints of the book. And yeah, we had a lot to say. We had a lot of thoughts on this book. But definitely, I just want to thank Amanda for doing that buddy read with me. It was my first one over on YouTube, so that was a lot of fun. And I probably wouldn't have picked this book up as soon as I did. I tend to have a bad habit of purchasing books and then taking a while to read them. But I was able to read this a lot sooner, and I was really happy that I did that. Let's move on to the genre of this book. This book is classified as a science fiction as well as a dystopian fiction book. It is reminiscent of George Orwell's 1984, where we have this big brother type entity or authoritarian government kind of taking control of a group of people. And that's pretty much what we see in this book. So that's why it's classified under the dystopian subgenre of science fiction. But let's jump to what this book is about. So this book was originally published in 1994 in Japanese, and then in 2019 it was translated to the English by Stephen Snyder. This book takes place on like this unnamed island in Japan, and things are disappearing from the memory of the people that live there. They are under the rule of this authoritarian enforcement agency called the Memory Police, whose job is to enforce the disappearances of whatever it was that they chose to disappear. The majority of the people on this island are able to forget the things that they desire to be forgotten, but there are a small group of people that are still able to remember those objects that are being forced to disappear. They wind up living in secrecy and in hiding in order to not be taken away or punished by the memory police. Throughout this story, our unnamed protagonist, she's a writer, a novelist, and she's working on her book, but she's one of those people that is unable to remember things or recall the memories that the memory police is taking away from the people, but her editor is, and his name is R. Our protagonist is trying to write her story, and her editor is able to remember things, so she decides to take it upon herself to try to hide him in her house. They make like a little safe house for him, and while he's in hiding, he's trying to help her push through her forgotten memories in order to complete her novel. Let's talk about what I liked about this book. First and foremost, I really liked how smooth this translation of this work was. I felt like from the very first page, I was hooked into the writing style and the story itself. We start off with a conversation between our protagonist and her mother, and they're talking about the mystery of the island and the disappearances. I also really like the format of this book. I know this is probably not a big deal for other people, but I really like this in books where the chapters are a lot shorter than like the chapters in, I'm gonna say like like Game of Thrones, right? Like the chapters are really long. Like the chapters in this book were a lot shorter than I expected them to be. And I really like that because there was a lot of good breaking points. And as a mom, I need some breaks because I need to put my book down at certain times and like make sure my kid's not throwing stuff in the toilet. You know what I mean? So I really appreciate when a book has shorter chapters just for that, just for me. That might be kind of selfish, but I like that in the book. But let's talk about the story itself. I really like the whole idea of the memory police. You have this mysterious presence on this island, and who gave them authority? Where did they come from? We don't know, but the whole idea of them was something I really liked. And even though it's not something that is resolved, I felt like the intrigue of whatever it is that they are was really intriguing, and it kept pulling me into the story because I wanted to know more about them. I also really like the message of the book, or the grand idea of the book, where the objects that we have in our lives hold this sort of meaning to them, and they hold more power than what we give them credit for. Certain items have the power to trigger memories or ideas or essentially freedom, if you take it a little bit further. You can hold a specific object in your hand, and to like a random person, they just see the object for what it is. But for the person that owns that object, it might be something more because it triggers like a certain memory or an association, whatever it may be, that gives it more value than what it is on the surface. You can even go a little further with that idea where a certain object in your life can represent a connection to a past life or a person. This is one of the reasons why I gave this book the rating that I did, because there's more to certain things in your lives than what you originally intend them to be. That message was something that I really liked in this book. So I'll just give you an example, right? So this keychain, right? It's just a little keychain. It's just a little dog. You know, to you guys, all you see is a keychain. But to me, this little keychain means the world to me. This little guy right here. So this used to belong to my cousin, and he passed away a number of years ago. He was very young. During his funeral, I asked his sister if I can have a little something from him. My cousin Rudy had like a collection of these guys, and I asked if I can have one just to remember him by. So if I were to lose this, I'd be like devastated. You know what I mean? But to you guys, it's just a little keychain, right? And this was something that we saw over and over again in this book, where our main character would hold an object and she's sort of enticed to remember what it is, because they can see an object that's been disappeared and they'd be like, well, you know, let's pretend like keychains have disappeared, right? She'd be like, oh, it's a, I don't know, it's just a keychain. Like, it's just a little plastic thing, right? They wouldn't understand that it's a keychain. But to the person holding it, she might remember like, oh, like my mom gave me the keychain or something. Like, the day that she gave it to me, it was raining or something. Like, it triggers a memory rather than triggering what the object was. And that was something that was repeated over and over again in this story, because the objects have power to trigger these memory responses, but not so much the purpose of whatever it was the thing was. So going back to this example, it's just a keychain, but it connects me to my cousin, and it triggers these memories of him that bring comfort to me knowing that I have this, even though it's just a little keychain. You know what I mean? So that's sort of this idea was represented throughout this book, and I really like that. It's this idea of objects holding power and what happens to people when that is taken away from them and how empty they can become. I'm sure there's more to the book, but that was the main thing that I sort of resonated with in this book. But let's talk about a few dislikes. One of the things that I didn't really like about this book is that there really isn't a resolution in terms of the memory police itself. This story sort of just focuses on the protagonist and the editor, the old man, and the story that she's trying to write. If that's something that, if you thought this was going to be like an action-packed story where they're toppling down this memory police authoritarian system. This is not that story. So if that's something you're looking for, this is not it. Even though that didn't happen with this story, I still really liked it in terms of the ideas that it represented and how this enforcement agency had an effect on the people of this island. I feel like that was more the focus on this in this story. So even though it's a dislike in terms of not having resolution with the memory police, I still really liked where the story went. So another thing I disliked about this book, and this might be a little spoilery, feel free to skip ahead if you don't want to hear this, but the main character and the editor, I did not like them. I did not care for them simply because of their behavior and the choices they made in terms of their relationship with each other. Everything else was cool. I liked the idea of the safe house. I liked the, you know, him trying to help her trigger these memories, them working on the book. All of that was great. It was just a relationship with each other that I didn't appreciate. And for the simple fact that R, the editor, is a married man. And I don't like that. Anytime that there's a story with cheating behavior, it's not that I can't read it in a book, because I can. It's just a matter of me not connecting with that character anymore. Like, I lose respect for people that engage in that sort of behavior, and in real life and in fiction. It's just one of those things that I just think is so rude and such a waste of time in terms of engaging in that behavior, like, and you're stringing people along in order, and you're hurting them. Like, I don't like that people are capable of doing those things. So whenever I hear about somebody doing that in a book, in a movie, whatever, like, I think it's so rude, and I automatically disengage with that connection. Like, I can't empathize with that person anymore. And that's sort of what happens in this story with our main character and the editor. They wind up forming this connection, and he winds up, you know, cheating on his wife with this novelist, right? The whole time that he's in hiding, his wife is taking care of his baby, and they only talk, like, through letters and stuff, and he doesn't talk about his connection with this novelist. And I just think that's really rude. I don't like that. And just to go along this idea, it just reminded me of, like, again, skip ahead if you don't want to hear this, but a couple years ago when everyone was, like, so hype over Daisy Jones and the Six, that was the same sort of feelings I had with that book, where everyone was like, oh my god, Daisy, she's so cool and troubled and this is not. But meanwhile, she's over here flirting with a married man, and I'm like, yo, his wife is taking care of the kids. He's over here writing songs with this girl just to make hits and stuff. And their connection is making them want to write these amazing songs. But I could care less about these songs if you're hurting your wife. Like, if you are hurting the people that you love because of this stupid connection that you feel you have with someone else, like, I feel like that's so rude and terrible that I can no longer engage or connect with that person. So when everyone was connecting with Daisy Jones, I was over here like, yo, she's mad rude. I don't like that. Like, she can go somewhere, like, go somewhere else. Like, I don't like that. And so I'm sorry, I'm ranting right now, but it's just something I dislike in people that can engage in that sort of behavior. And when I see it in fiction, it's just an automatic, you're rude, I don't like you. It might be a bias, but it's just one of those things. Like, if you meet a person in real life that's like a serial killer, you're like, I'm not gonna like that person. This is just one of those things for me. Yeah, I just don't agree with that behavior, and to see that in the book makes me not like that character, and that's sort of what happened here. So yeah, rant over. I'm sorry, but not sorry. But let's talk about my rating. So aside from my dislike of the main character, I still gave this book a high rating because of the whole idea of the book. I gave it 4 out of 5 stars, higher than what Amanda gave this book. I believe she gave this book 3 stars, but I'm giving it 4. I love the message of this book. I thought the whole idea of the memory police was executed in a very unique way. I'm still thinking about this book even having finished it about a week ago. I'm still thinking about some of the things in this book. I'm still thinking about the idea. I'm making personal connections in my life. Like, this book has really grandiose ideas, which we can see throughout this whole book, even though it's very quiet in nature, this book. But who do I recommend this book to? If you like slower paced, cerebral type books, this might be for you. It's also for those who like dystopian style books as well. If you like a story within a story, this might also be for you because we get glimpses of the novel that she's writing as well. And the story is really weird, but cool at the same time. Like, it took a turn that I wasn't expecting, and I like that. Even though it came as a surprise, the fact that we were reading parts of her book. But I felt like that story was really thought-provoking as well. This book is not for those that are looking for a sort of toppling of the regime, right? A revolution. Like, this is not for you if you're looking for that, because this is more of a quiet book, character focus, how it impacts the people. That's more so what you're going to get with this one, not this whole revolution, right? Like, that's not what you're getting. But with all of that said, and my mini rant, that is all I have to say about this book. Those are my thoughts on The Memory Police by Yoko Ogawa. If you have read this book, let me know what you think about this book. Am I crazy for thinking the way that I did? Am I being a little too harsh on our characters here? Let me know what you think, because I have my thoughts. But I'm open to hear what other people have to say about this and what I ranted about in this story. I would love to hear your take on that. If you are interested in reading this book, let me know that as well. The comment section is open for any and all thoughts. I would love to hear them. But give this video a like if you enjoyed it, and subscribe if you want to see more. And I hope you all have an amazing day.